Michael O'Mara Books presents The Beginning and End of Everything, From the Big Bang to the End of the Universe, written by Paul Parsons and read by Dallas Campbell. Introduction. One day, nearly 14 billion years ago, something remarkable happened. Our universe was born. The matter and energy making up everything that you can see around you in the world today, this book, the air you breathe, the biological material in your body, the light from the sun and the distant stars, everything were all born out of that one single instant of creation. Today, this material is spread across a truly vast universe. We don't know exactly how big that universe is, but just the bit we can see spans some 92 billion light years. A light year is the distance that light can travel in a year. A billion is 1,000 million. The light from the furthest object we can see, a very distant collection of stars called a galaxy, started its journey through space 13.4 billion years ago. That's many billions of years before our own sun and solar system had even formed. Looking up at the night sky on a clear evening, you might wonder where it all came from, how all the matter in the universe organized itself into galaxies full of stars, where the vastness of space ends, and how long into the future our universe might continue to exist for. These are questions that have vexed our greatest thinkers since the beginning of recorded history. And yet now, we have many of the answers, a fact almost as remarkable as the answers themselves. For millennia, our beliefs about the universe were grounded in religion and the notion of a creator, and woe betide anyone who dared challenge this with more scientific alternatives. The earliest secular views of the universe weren't perfect either. For example, the ancient Greek philosophers placed the Earth at the centre of the universe, with the sun and the planets and the distant stars all wheeling around it. With the invention of the telescope in the 17th century, observations of the night sky, the evidence against which theories of the universe can be tested, started to accumulate. And with that, cosmology, the study of the universe at large, became a quantitative science. Telescopic measurements of outer space began to whittle away at the permitted range of cosmological theories, because any theory that didn't square with observations could immediately be discarded. In particular, astronomers discovered in the 1920s that space is expanding. This would reduce the number of mainstream viable theories to just two. One said the universe had a definite beginning in a superheated, superdense state, and the other said it had existed forever. The debate raged between these two competing possibilities for decades, but was finally settled in the 1960s, when observations demonstrated that the universe really was hotter and denser in the past. This meant that the cosmos hasn't been around forever, but was created in an ancient, tumultuous event which has become known as the Big Bang. Suddenly, where before there was nothing, absolutely nothing, not just no matter and no energy, but no space and not even time as we know it, the universe burst violently into existence. The Belgian cosmologist and Catholic priest Georges Lemaître, who had become instrumental in the development of the Big Bang theory, later referred to the Big Bang rather poetically as a day without yesterday, for it was the beginning of time itself. The Big Bang started as a hot, dense fireball, a twisted knot of matter, energy, space, and time. How and why it appeared when it did is anyone's guess. Many physicists believe the answer lies in the complex laws of quantum physics, which shaped the microscopic world of subatomic particles and the web of interactions between them. In this regime, particles are known to pop in and out of existence, bubbling up from the quantum realm and then disappearing again a short time later. Because our universe was so tiny and compact during the Big Bang, it seems it must have been governed by quantum laws, to some extent, making it plausible to suppose that it burst onto the scene in much the same way. And then what? Most quantum particles created from nothing like this simply vanish again a short time later. And the more matter or energy that you borrow from the quantum bank, the sooner the debt must be repaid, i.e. big particles vanish quickly and smaller particles stick around for a while. But today, the universe is billions of years old and enormous, and isn't showing any signs of going anywhere just yet. Incredibly, the reason why may be that, despite its imposing appearance, the total mass of the universe is in fact zero. This is because gravitational fields carry energy. The gravitational energy is actually negative, and in some cosmological models is exactly equal and opposite to the contents of the universe, so the two cancel each other out. If that's the case, then our credit at the quantum bank is very good, and the universe is free to exist for a very long time indeed. From the early chaotic maelstrom of the Big Bang emerged the laws of physics themselves, which govern how the different forms of mass and energy interact with one another. That may seem surprising, but it's absolutely true. What's more, the process is essentially random. Run the process again, and you'll probably see a different set of laws created. As we'll see presently, there may well exist parallel universes in which different physical laws prevail. These laws marshaled the raw ingredients of the cosmos into the first chemical elements, the building blocks of everything you see in the world around you today. Tiny subatomic particles became welded together by powerful quantum forces to make the first atomic nuclei of hydrogen, the simplest chemical element, and these later fused to make the next element, helium. As space expanded and cooled, atoms and molecules of matter clumped together under gravity to form the galaxies, stars, and eventually planets that make up the majestic night sky admired by astronomers through their telescopes today. The very first galaxies actually grew from seed sown in the heat of the Big Bang, when from its birth the universe expanded outwards at extraordinary speed. Tiny variations in the density of matter caused by those same quantum particles blipping in and out of reality got blasted up to galaxy size by the rapid expansion. And gravity did the rest, hauling in more matter, so that before long, these cosmic acorns had grown into mighty galaxies. Galaxies are a spectacular sight. Cosmic islands, each home to hundreds of billions of stars, wheeling in the empty darkness of space. But in fact, what we can see of galaxies is just the tip of a cosmic iceberg. For all the bright, luminous material we can gaze out upon today through a telescope, there is about five times as much invisible material, or dark matter, to use the correct term. We know it's there because the way galaxies move doesn't square with the gravity of their bright stuff, that is the parts we can see, stars and glowing clouds of gas, alone. But so far, no one knows what it is. Galaxies span typically tens to hundreds of thousands of light years in diameter, where a light year is simply the distance that light can travel in an interval of 1 year, equal to a little under 9,500,000,000,000 kilometers. Galaxies are social animals, aggregating into groups known as clusters, which are typically home to 100 to 1,000 galaxies, and can be anything up to a few tens of millions of light years across. And those don't like to live alone either. Rather, they stick together in groups, each harbouring up to 10 clusters called superclusters, which are huge, spanning anything up to thousands of millions of light years. But that's still small fry compared to the size of the wider universe. Our observable universe, defined as the furthest we can see out into space through the most powerful telescopes from one side of the night sky to the other, has continued to expand from the earliest moments after creation. What started life smaller than the tiniest subatomic particle is now unimaginably vast and is home to hundreds of billions of galaxies, the most remote of which are so distant that their light has taken billions of years to reach us, meaning that we see them as they were in the dim and distant past, while other galaxies are so far removed that their light has yet to reach us at all. The observable universe is a mind-boggling 92 billion light years across, And it's growing larger every single day as ever more distant regions of space roll into view, their faint light reaching the Earth for the very first time. This ability to gaze into cosmic history has given cosmologists, scientists who study the behaviour of the universe at large, key insights into how the searing temperatures and crushing pressures of the Big Bang evolved into the comparatively temperate and peaceful universe that we observe and inhabit today. It's also shown us that our universe isn't behaving quite as it should, given what we know about gravity. Being able to look back through cosmic time means that astronomers can chart how the expansion rate of the universe has evolved. In the late 1990s, astronomers did this for some of the most distant and therefore oldest galaxies in the universe, finding that cosmic expansion is accelerating. That was an enormous shock. Throw a ball up into the air and it comes back down because of Earth's gravity. Similarly, physicists were expecting the gravity of the universe to be pulling space back on itself, not making it race away at an ever-increasing rate. The reason for the apparent anomaly, it soon became clear, was that even dark matter isn't the dominant substance filling the universe. There's something far bigger out there, known as dark energy, and its gravity is repulsive. The German physicist and father of relativity theory, Albert Einstein, was in fact the first to suggest the existence of dark energy, albeit that he gave it a different name. This being before astronomers discovered that the universe is expanding, he believed it should be static and unchanging, and so he introduced a repulsive force to his general theory of relativity, essentially a theory of gravity, but more on this later, to counteract the universe's attractive gravity over very large distances and hold it still. But when, in the late 1920s, astronomers found that the universe really is expanding, he was forced to dismiss his idea as ridiculous. The fact that we're able to comprehend the origin and evolution of the universe and our place within it is a tribute to the power of the human intellect. The scientific method, that is, formulating well-structured theories and then testing them against observations, has led cosmologists to understand the history of the universe all the way back to the first instance after the moment of creation. We now know that the universe is roughly 13.8 billion years old. Keen listeners may be wondering, if the universe is 13.8 billion years old, then how can the part of it we can see, the observable universe, possibly be 92 billion light years in diameter? In other words, how can we see the light from objects 46 billion light years away when it's only had 13.8 billion years to get here? Rest assured, we will come to this later. However you slice it, 13.8 billion years is very old indeed. By comparison, the Sun and the solar system formed around 4.6 billion years ago. Life on Earth emerged 4 billion years ago. Our planet's first multicellular organisms 1.7 billion years ago. And modern animals 550 million years ago. While the first modern humans, the species Homo sapiens, didn't walk the planet until just 200,000 years ago. That is just 0.0002 billion years back, or around 1/100,000th of the age of the universe. Put another way, if the history of the universe could be condensed into a year, with a Big Bang taking place just after midnight on the 1st of January, and the present day corresponding to midnight on the 31st of December, then humans arose around 8 minutes before the end of the year. Modern science all happened in the last 1.4 seconds. All the timescales that we're familiar with from everyday experience are utterly dwarfed next to the gargantuan age of our cosmos. We also know how much matter there is in our universe, even if we don't fully understand exactly what it's all made from. And with the exception of the very earliest moments after the universe was born, we know how the laws of physics operate within it. Although, as we'll see later on, the physics of the Big Bang itself, what caused it, and what may even have happened beforehand, is still highly speculative. And we also know that our planet, the Earth, orbits an ordinary star in an ordinary galaxy in a very ordinary corner of the cosmos. His blunder with dark energy aside, Albert Einstein laid much of the groundwork for modern cosmology. His magnum opus on gravity, the general theory of relativity, is the framework upon which the subject is built. Einstein is one of a number of pioneers who we must thank for our understanding of the universe today. The theory of relativity emerged in the early 20th century from the ideas of Sir Isaac Newton 250 years earlier. In 1927, Georges Lemaître used general relativity to forge the first mathematical models of the universe. Later, visionary scientists such as the Professor Stephen Hawking took these models and pushed them to their extremes to make bold new inferences, detailing, for instance, how the universe might have arisen from nothing, and how the rapid expansion of the early universe laid the seeds for the formation of galaxies. Also to be acknowledged are the great astronomers, the people who gathered the data against which the craziest theories devised by cosmologists could be tested. Among them are Charles Messier, who made the first catalogue of bodies outside our own Milky Way galaxy, Edwin Hubble and his assistant Milton Humason, who discovered the expansion of the universe, and Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson, the two radio astronomers who made the first detection of the cosmic microwave background radiation, the echo from the hot fires of the Big Bang, which still resonate through space today and which remain one of the principal pillars by which the Big Bang theory is vindicated over its competitors. In recent decades, the contribution of individual astronomers has been generally replaced by that of large international collaborations, often using multiple telescopes or even purpose-built spacecraft to gather large volumes of high-quality data. This was how dark energy was ultimately discovered, and how the details locked away in the structure of the cosmic microwave background have been extracted and used to fine-tune our modern picture of the cosmos. Inevitably, studies of the universe's history have led to speculation about its future. And if cosmologists' best theories are to be believed, then it won't be around forever, at least not as we know it. There are two main contenders for its ultimate fate. The first suggests that gravity will slowly halt and then reverse the cosmic expansion, leading to a calamitous antithesis of the Big Bang, known as the Big Crunch. For this to happen, the attractive gravity of the universe must be powerful enough to overcome not just the expansion of space, but also the repulsion generated by dark energy. If the universe ends in a big crunch, all matter will be obliterated, and the universe most definitely burns out rather than fading away. In contrast, the other possibility has the universe bowing out rather more gently. In this scenario, known as the heat death, the universe has insufficient gravity to halt its expansion, and space continues to grow larger for eternity. That might sound like good news at first, but eventually the stars run out of fuel and die. The cosmic expansion that saved us from the mayhem of a big crunch stretches space apart so much that other galaxies recede away at faster than the speed of light, ultimately disappearing from view. The night sky is now utterly dark and empty. The remaining matter is gradually hoovered up into black holes from where it slowly degrades to nothing, and the universe slips away into an inky black slumber. There are variations on these themes. For example, some cosmologists have wondered whether the universe might bounce back from a big crunch and enter a new phase of expansion, or whether it may already have done so, and what we see in the heavens today is just the latest in an eternal cycle of expansion and contraction. Equally, some have wondered whether a heat death could be more extreme than predicted. Indeed, if dark energy took on a form known as phantom energy, then the expansion rate of the universe in the far future could be so rapid that it would tear stars and planets apart, ultimately shredding atoms and molecules and even the fabric of space itself. Other physicists wonder whether our universe could be just one of very many, a multitude of parallel universes, each similar but subtly different to our own. It might not be much consolation as our own universe falls to bits, but if the multiverse really does exist, then at least some aspect of the reality we've known will live on. This book is the story of the Big Bang theory of our universe, from birth to death. You may be familiar with some elements of the narrative already, like the idea that the universe had a beginning, or that space is expanding, or that we inhabit a galaxy of stars called the Milky Way, which is rather like an island universe, one of many in a vast cosmic ocean. But to really get your head around what happened in those first few moments and why, a comprehensive overview is essential. Every part of the story is so inextricably linked that we must travel the full distance of the journey so far to understand both our present and our likely future. We'll hear about the possibility of space and time having not four, but 26 dimensions, and that the Big Bang might have been caused by a massive collision between our universe and another, as well as the fact that details of our cosmic past and vital clues to its future are right now being swept across space as ripples in the very fabric of space and time itself. Along the way, we'll witness spectacular vistas, grapple with bewildering mysteries, and recount incredible tales of scientific deduction by some of the most brilliant human minds to have ever lived. We're going to go on one of the most incredible journeys imaginable to chart the story of the universe from the beginning of time to its ultimate demise many billions of years from now. Quite literally, the beginning and the end of everything. Chapter 1. Our place in the universe. We are an impossibility in an impossible universe. Ray Bradbury. Before science emerged as a tool for explaining the world, early cosmological theories were driven largely by religious ideas. Some 3,200 years ago, the Mesopotamian people, who lived in what is now Iraq, Kuwait, and Saudi Arabia, believed that the god Marduk cleaved the body of the primeval mother Tiamat in two. One half formed the earth, the other the heavens. The ancient Chinese believed that our universe began as a chaotic, amorphous cloud that for tens of thousands of years slowly coalesced into a cosmic egg from which hatched Pangu, the first living being. Pangu fashioned the earth and the sky and spent the next 18,000 years driving them apart. After this, Pangu died and his remains became embodied in the universe. His left eye became the sun, his right eye the moon, and his hair became the stars. Some religious cosmologies resonate with more modern scientific ideas. For example, Buddhists believe that the universe is eternal, having neither a beginning nor an end, which is reminiscent of the steady-state theory, an idea that was a serious competitor to the Big Bang model until as late as the 1960s. While Hindus advocate a cyclic cosmology, similar to modern theories in which the universe goes through alternating phases of expansion and contraction, Buddhism is possibly unique among religions in that its picture of the universe does not feature an omnipotent creator. Many early religions, particularly in Egypt, ancient Rome, and North America, idolized the sun. In Britain, historians believe the megalithic monument at Stonehenge may have served as a primitive astronomical observatory from which pagan worshippers could gauge the timings of the winter and summer solstices. As our understanding of the natural world grew during the Renaissance, so science came to challenge many religious ideas, and this has made the relationship between science and religion an often difficult one. Some scientists were persecuted for their ideas, others were more wily, not having their work published until after their deaths. Some expressed religious beliefs openly. British physicist Isaac Newton, for example, held strong religious views that would have counted in his favour, and he was cunning enough not to speak publicly about his more radical opinions. It's an uneasy alliance that continues to this day, with some hardliner atheists insisting that religion damages science, whilst others believe the two can coexist. Perhaps most prominent is the dispute between advocates of evolution by natural selection, Charles Darwin's theory for how species developed and adapt to their environment, and those who believe in creationism, the modern name for the idea that the heaven and the earth were forged by a supreme being. Creationism is a view still adhered to by some followers of Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, among others. For example, in the biblical book of Genesis, God is said to have created the universe and everything in it in 6 days. Creationists defy all the evidence to the contrary. For instance, young Earth creationists believe that the universe came into existence just 10,000 years ago, despite there being clear evidence from rocks, ice cores, and even the oldest living trees that the Earth alone is a lot older than this, before any recourse is made to the astronomical evidence, which, as we've seen, and we'll discuss more later, suggests that the universe was born many billions of years earlier. And that's the core difference between science and religion. Religious statements are taken on faith, whereas scientific theories must be vindicated by hard evidence. In science, facts are paramount, be they simple accounts of our everyday experience, evidence gathered by geologists, observations of distant galaxies collected by astronomers, or experimental data teased from the fabric of reality by a multi-billion-dollar particle accelerator. Scientific theories are attempts to explain the world in a logical, systematic way. Crucially, in a way that makes hard and fast predictions that can be tested against facts, be they existing observations, future observations, or those observations for which an experiment can be devised and carried out. Sometimes the facts may be uncomfortable or unexpected, or may challenge our preconceptions. In science, that's just tough. If the facts are at odds with the theory, then the theory goes in the bin, and the scientists return to the drawing boards, or, as is more likely the case, their notebooks and computers. Rejecting a theory isn't disastrous. In fact, it's a good thing. This is how science really moves on. It's how we know, for example, that the Earth is spherical, not flat, that our planet orbits the Sun and not vice versa, and that the Earth most definitely isn't merely 10,000 years old, the best estimates we have today, but the true figure, closer to 4.543 billion years. Making the observations that prove a theory wrong is one of the most powerful things a scientist can do, and also one of the most painful when the theory they're disproving is their own. The first scientist that we know of was the Greek philosopher Thales of Miletus, who lived between the 6th and 7th century BCE. Thales was the first person, at least in recorded history, to shun the notion that the heavens and the earth were created by mysterious and unfathomable gods. Instead, he tried to link effects with their observable causes in the real world. Among his achievements were geometrical techniques for calculating the dimensions of pyramids and for triangulating the position of ships. He also, correctly, predicted a solar eclipse in 585 BCE and reportedly used his scientific knowledge for weather forecasting. Despite Thales's pioneering talents, the prevailing cosmological view to emerge from ancient Greece was that of the celestial spheres, which held that the moon, the planets, the sun were each embedded in one of a set of nested concentric spheres centered on the Earth. Each sphere's unique rotation around the Earth determined the observed motion of its associated heavenly body. The outermost sphere held the distant stars, and since these were believed to be fixed in space, it was static. We now know that this theory is about as wrong as it's possible to be. Modern observations show the Sun lies at the centre of our solar system and is orbited by the Earth and the other planets. Our moon circles the Earth, whilst the distant stars move independently of the Sun and its retinue of worlds. Interestingly, the Greeks had evidence to prove that the celestial bodies weren't quite behaving as the theory of the spheres dictated. Different orbital speeds of the planets meant that, when viewed from the Earth, some can appear to speed up or slow down, and sometimes even to move backwards in their orbits. This backward or retrograde motion is quite at odds with the Greek view of them following a smooth circular path around the Earth. One Greek astronomer, Aristarchus of Samos, did make the connection and suggested that the planets circle the Sun, not vice versa. Aristarchus's original work has been lost, but the theory is reported by Archimedes in his book The Sand Reckoner. Sadly, Aristarchus's theory fell into obscurity while the retrograde motion of the planets was misinterpreted. The Greek philosopher Ptolemy endeavoured to explain it within the celestial spheres theory by supposing that planets didn't occupy fixed points in their respective spheres, but instead underwent small orbits around them, known as epicycles. When the epicycle carried the planet in the same direction as its sphere was rotating, the planet appeared to speed up, and when moving in the opposite direction, it seemed to slow down or move in retrograde. The idea of epicycles was at best a patch on an already broken theory, but it was enough to ensure that the celestial spheres model staggered on until the beginning of the Renaissance. It was here, during the early 16th century, that the Polish astronomer Nicholas Copernicus realized the observed motion of the planets could all be explained far more naturally if they orbited the Sun rather than the Earth. This heliocentric view became a turning point in astronomy and indeed science in general. Copernicus is believed to have shared early drafts of his theory with close acquaintances in or around the year 1514. It would become the central pillar of his book De Revolutionibus Orbium Celestium, on the revolutions of the celestial spheres, which Copernicus completed in the early 1530s, although fearing persecution at the hands of the Catholic Church for defying the established dogma, he didn't dare publish it until the year of his death in 1543. Although a gargantuan stride in the right direction, Copernicus's heliocentric theory still supposed that the Sun was at the centre of the entire universe. In 1576, British astronomer and mathematician Thomas Digges put forward the bold suggestion that the universe is actually infinite and the stars are objects much like our Sun, which are evenly distributed through it. He was motivated to rethink the nature of the stars by a supernova, a violent explosion marking the death of a massive star, which he observed in 1572. This event was in blatant contradiction of the Greek view of the spheres, which held that the distant stars are fixed and unchanged. Digges's suggestion that the stars lay at varying distances from the Earth was lent additional weight in the early 17th century by the Italian thinker Galileo Galilei. Throughout his life, Galileo made seminal contributions to mathematics, physics, engineering, and astronomy. In 1609, he had learned about the invention by a group of Dutch spectacle makers the previous year of the refracting telescope, a device using a pair of glass lenses to magnify the image of a distant object. Intrigued and seeing immediately the potential benefits for astronomy, Galileo set about constructing his own version. His telescope had only 3 times magnification, but that was enough to transform his view, not to mention human understanding of the heavens. Just half a century after Digges's initial suggestion that the stars are distributed through space, Galileo discovered that more stars were visible when he squinted through his telescope than when he looked with the unaided eye. Although some of the new stars that he was seeing must naturally have been intrinsically fainter, their sheer number meant that some must appear fainter because they're further away. In other words, the stars don't all lie at the same distance away from us as the celestial spheres theory required. Galileo wasn't done yet. The following year, he turned his telescope onto the planet Venus, finding it to have phases, much like the phases of the moon, full moon, new moon, gibbous, and so on. The moon's different phases are caused as it's illuminated by the sun from different directions whilst moving in its month-long orbit around the Earth. In the celestial spheres theory, Venus must always lie between the Earth and the Sun, and that means that we should only be able to see it with new and crescent phases. However, Galileo saw that Venus displayed the full range of phases, supporting the idea that both planets circled the Sun. Galileo set down these conclusions in his book, Dialogo sopra I due massimi sistemi del mondo, Dialogue Concerning the Two Chief World Systems, published in 1632. In this text, and in conversation, he was quite open about his belief in Copernicus's heliocentric theory, and this would ultimately prove to be his undoing, vindicating Copernicus's earlier decision not to publish the theory until his death. In 1633, Galileo was tried for heresy by the Catholic Inquisition and found guilty. Publication of his work was subsequently prohibited, and Galileo spent the final years of his life under house arrest. He was reportedly spared torture and a grisly death only because his scientific achievements had earned him allies in powerful places. Galileo died from natural causes in 1642. But his insights lived on. In 1750, English astronomer Thomas Wright built upon another of Galileo's findings, that the Milky Way, the pale, diffuse band of light that's visible across the sky on a dark, clear night, is in fact a vast swarm of stars. In his book, An Original Theory or New Hypothesis of the Universe, Wright suggested that the Milky Way is a disk of stars and that our Sun and solar system are embedded within the disk. Rather than being dotted liberally throughout space, as diggers had suggested, Wright imagined that stars are clustered into a multitude of cosmic islands, each resembling the Milky Way, and which would be later dubbed galaxies. What we were seeing in the Milky Way, he asserted, was the edge-on plane of our own galaxy as viewed from the inside. By this time, the Church's stance against the heliocentric view had begun to wane, and the true nature of the solar system as a collection of planets all circling the Sun was gaining acceptance. In 1755, the German philosopher Immanuel Kant suggested that the disk of our galaxy, identified as such by Wright, could be rotating, with the stars held in orbit around the galaxy by gravity, just as it holds the planets in their orbit around the Sun. Indeed, Newton's law of gravity requires the stars to be orbiting, else they would all simply fall radially inwards to the galaxy's centre. The evidence that they really are celestial objects lying outside the Milky Way was found by astronomers studying comets. These are chunks of ice and dirt, now known to be leftovers from the formation of the Sun and planets, which wander the outer reaches of the solar system. It might seem strange that a family of objects living on our cosmic doorstep could have led to a breakthrough in the understanding of the universe at large, but when a comet passes near to the Sun, its surface vaporizes into a cloud of steam and other gases that reflect back sunlight to create a fuzzy glowing patch on the night sky. Comet hunters scour the skies looking for these telltale smudges of light, quite distinct from the bright pinprick of a star. Because comets are part of the solar system and orbit the Sun just like planets, their positions change significantly with time as they move along their orbits. And as a comet's orbit carries it nearer to the Sun, so the heat increases the amount of gas boiling off from its surface, causing it to brighten. At least, that's what they're supposed to do. During the late 18th century, some astronomers began to find faint, fuzzy objects that resembled comets, but which didn't seem to be moving or change their brightness. These baffling objects became known as nebulae, after nebula, the Latin word meaning cloud. French comet hunter Charles Messier, working with his assistant Pierre Méchain, drew up the first systematic list of these nebulae. The opening edition of the so-called Messier catalogue was published in 1774 and contained 103 Messier objects, designated by their characteristic M numbers. Today the list has grown to 110, and it's considered a significant badge of honour among amateur astronomers to successfully spot all of them in a single night's observing, a feat known as the Messier Marathon. But back in the late 18th century, the puzzle remained. What exactly are they? Answering that question took almost 50 years and involved a new field of experimental science called spectroscopy, splitting white light up into its spectrum of colours and measuring the brightness of each colour. When we look at a rainbow, each colour is made of light with a particular range of wavelengths. For example, red light has a wavelength centred on 700 millionths of a millimetre, whereas the violet light at the other end of the rainbow has a much shorter wavelength of around 400 millionths of a millimetre. Light is split into a spectrum by refraction, a process where the path of a light beam passing between two different media, air and the water of raindrops in the case of a rainbow, gets bent by an amount depending on its wavelength. Short wavelengths, e.g. violet, are bent most of all, while long wavelengths, e.g. red, are bent least, which causes a parallel beam of white light to fan out into its constituent colours. The great physicist Sir Isaac Newton, about whom we'll learn more in the next chapter, had demonstrated in the 1670s that a beam of white light can be broken up into its spectrum by refraction through a glass prism. The English chemist William Hyde Wollaston improved on Newton's experimental setup by using a lens to focus the spectrum onto a large screen. When, in 1802, Wollaston did this with light from the sun, he found that the resulting colours weren't of even brightness, but were punctuated by dark bands, essentially missing wavelengths in the light spectrum. These bands were studied further by the Bavarian physicist Joseph von Fraunhofer, who identified and catalogued nearly 600 of them, which are still known today as Fraunhofer lines. But it wasn't until the 1860s that their true nature was finally unravelled by the German chemists Robert Bunsen and Gustav Kirchhoff. By studying light produced by flames while burning various chemical elements and compounds, they noted that each substance introduced a different pattern of bands into the spectra, some dark, but also some light. The inference was that particular substances absorb and re-emit light at certain characteristic wavelengths. So, if you look at the spectrum of a flame and then burn a substance known to absorb at wavelength X and emit at wavelength Y, you'll see the observed spectrum acquire a dark band at wavelength X and a bright band at wavelength Y. The true nature of the Fraunhofer lines in the spectrum of the sun thus became clear. They are a chemical fingerprint telling astronomers exactly what our neighbourhood star is made from. Indeed, the chemical element helium was initially discovered in 1868 as a hitherto unknown bright yellow line in the sun's spectrum. Accordingly, it was named after the Greek word helios, meaning sun. Helium wasn't found on Earth until 1895, making its existence one of spectroscopy's first predictions. Spectroscopy works because of a complex branch of science known as quantum mechanics, which we'll come to in more detail in Chapter 6. But the basic gist is as follows. All chemical elements are made up of basic building blocks called atoms. The atom is composed of a central nucleus made up of positively charged subatomic particles called protons and uncharged particles called neutrons of about the same mass. It would take about 1.5 million billion billion protons or neutrons to weigh a single gram. Without the neutrons there to act as a spacer, the electrostatic repulsion between protons and larger atoms would cause the nucleus to fly apart. Around the nucleus circles a cloud of negatively charged particles known as electrons. There are usually about the same number of electrons as there are protons in the nucleus, and each electron is 1,750 times lighter than a proton. Electrons are characterized by their energy. A tennis ball served from one end of a court to the other possesses energy by virtue of its motion, and the faster it moves, the more energy it has. The allowed energy states of a tennis ball are said to be continuous because they can take any value. I can hit the ball a tiny bit harder than I did last time, and it'll have a tiny bit more energy. And there's no limit to how tiny that extra bit of energy can be. In the picture of an atom that prevailed before the discovery of quantum mechanics, sometimes referred to as classical physics, an electron is also allowed to have whatever energy it likes. Like the tennis ball, its energy states are continuous. However, in the quantum world, electrons don't enjoy quite the same liberties. One of the central tenets of quantum theory is that energy only comes in discrete lumps called quanta, meaning that only certain energy states or levels of the electron are permitted. This is key to spectroscopy, because when light gets absorbed by a substance, what's actually happening is that the energy is being soaked up by the electrons in the atoms of the substance. The energy that the light loses raises the energy of the electrons in the atoms. But because of quantum mechanics, the electrons can only soak up light with energy that matches the gap between any two of their allowed energy levels. Because the energy of light is uniquely determined by its wavelength, the net effect of a substance absorbing light at a particular energy is to create a dark band at the corresponding wavelength in the light spectrum. Similarly, electrons can drop down from a higher to a lower energy level and emit light of a specific wavelength, again corresponding to the gap in energy between the two levels involved. And this is how bright bands can appear in the light spectrum. Every unique chemical substance has a unique electron structure, meaning that every substance also has its own unique pattern of bright emission lines and dark absorption lines that can be detected when it burns in the flame of a candle or in the hot fires of a star like the sun. Take hydrogen, for example. It's the simplest chemical element, having a nucleus consisting of a proton with no neutrons that's orbited by a single electron. Hydrogen is characterized by three sets of bright emission lines, known as the Lyman, Balmer, and Paschen series, corresponding to the electron dropping down between different pairs of energy levels. Spectroscopy helped to revolutionize cosmology during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. For starters, revealing the true nature of Messier's mysterious nebulae. In the 1860s, astronomers split the light from the nebulae into its constituent colours and studied the resulting spectra. They saw that some had relatively simple patterns of lines, matching that of glowing hydrogen gas, and so were nothing but clouds of interstellar gas. Others, however, resembled the more complicated spectra of starlight. Roughly two-thirds of the nebulae fell into this latter category, which meant they had to be groups of stars. Many of these groups also displayed intricate swirling patterns, leading them to be called spiral nebulae. It's usually the case in science that answers bring more questions, and now the big mystery was whether or not the spiral nebulae lay inside or outside our Milky Way galaxy. There was no clear consensus. Some astronomers had noticed that there were more nebulae to be found in the plane of our galaxy's disk, suggesting they were in some way related to the galaxy and thus situated nearby. Others had occasionally observed stars in the spiral nebulae undergo a kind of flare-up known as a nova. The useful thing about novae is that they all have more or less the same inherent brightness. They are what astronomers refer to as standard candles. That means they can be used as a measure of distance. Look at a standard candle up close and it'll appear very bright. Look at one from afar and it'll appear much dimmer. This is because light spreads out in a sphere centered on its source. As you get further away from the source, the sphere that the star's light is spread over becomes larger, meaning that the fraction of the total light that's entering your eye must get smaller, making it appear fainter. If you measure how much fainter, then you can infer exactly how far away the star is. In 1917, four very dim, and therefore very distant, novae were seen in a spiral nebula known as Andromeda. The novae were so faint that they implied Andromeda had to be some 10 million light years away from the Earth. At around the same time, the Milky Way's disk had been sized up to just a few hundred thousand light years across by American astronomer Harlow Shapley, using a different kind of standard candle known as an RR Lyrae variable star. The first RR Lyrae star, the eponymous RR Lyrae in the constellation Lyra, was discovered in the 1890s by the American astronomer Edward Pickering. Roughly the same mass as the Sun and slightly hotter, RR Lyrae are called variable stars because their brightness fluctuates periodically. This is thought to be caused by physical pulsations in the star. It's expanding and contracting like a beating heart. As it contracts, it gets denser and more opaque, making it harder for light and radiative heat to escape. This drives the brightness down and the temperature up, causing the star to expand and become less dense.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.